Man, the open hymn writers, they just knew how to put it, didn't they? Man, alive. That, if you sit there as you're singing that song and just think about the words that you're singing, I mean, it just doesn't really get any better than that. I have no idea who wrote that hymn, but I can just picture that individual whenever they were writing it, pinning those words down, how much those words actually meant to that individual. Wow. Praise the Lord, church. God is good. All the time?
God is good.
Yeah, we're getting pretty good at that. Amen? As it is wonderful to be back in the house of God this morning. We had a wonderful vacation last week. We actually left last Friday evening. We were going to drive down to Weissville, Virginia. I think everybody probably knows where that's at. We were going to get a hotel, and then the next morning get up and just go on down Myrtle Beach. It'll only be about 4 hours. We were going to split it up. We got to Whiteville in the middle of the night, and there was not one room that was available. Every hotel was booked. Amanda called every single one of them in the town. So I said, well, it's no big deal. We'll just drive on down to Winston-Salem. At that point, I was still feeling pretty good. It was only about midnight or something like that. Maybe 1 in the morning. I can't remember. So we drove on down to Winston-Salem. And lo and behold, there was not a room that was available in Winston-Salem. So we went on down to High Point. There was not a room available at High Point. So we ended up driving all the way down to Myrtle Beach. I was worn out by the time that we got down there, but the boys were happy. They slept the whole way. And we had a wonderful, wonderful time together as a family. And you know what? That's what matters. Amen. I want to tell you this morning, guys, that there's nothing more important other than Christ and a relationship with Him, but secondly, come to family. And you need to spend time with your family. This past week was just a joy. I wouldn't trade it for anything. We had some eventful moments, that's for sure. But you know what? We got to spend time with our family, and it was wonderful. We praise God this morning for that. Does anybody have a word from the Lord this morning? Testimony on your heart? Rick, go ahead. Our series this morning on servanthood. We find ourselves in a passage this morning that is absolutely loaded down. I love it. Philippians chapter 3 may be one of my favorite chapters in the entire New Testament. And it begins there in verse 1. It says this, "Finally, my brethren, rejoice in the Lord. To write the same things to you, to me indeed, is not grievous, but for you it is safe." Listen to what he says in verse 2. "Beware of dogs. Beware of evil workers. Beware of concision. For we are the circumcision, which worship God in the Spirit and rejoice in Christ Jesus, and have no confidence in the flesh. Though I might also have confidence in the flesh, if any other man thinketh that he hath whereof he might trust in the flesh, I more, circumcised the eighth day of the stock of Israel, the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, as touching the law, a Pharisee concerning zeal, persecuting the church, touching the righteousness which is in the law, blameless. But what things were gained to me, those I counted loss for Christ. Yea, doubtless, and I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count them but dung, that I may win Christ." Verse 9, "and be found in him, not having my own righteousness which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith." Now pay very close attention to verse 10, because this is where we're going to sort of camp out this morning. He says, "that I may know him, and the power of his resurrection, and the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable unto his death, if by any means I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead. Not as though I had already attained, either were already perfect, but I follow after, if that I may apprehend that which for also I am apprehended of Christ Jesus. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do." And church, we're not going to be in verse 13 this morning, but I want you to pay very close attention to this. "This one thing that I do, forgetting those things which are behind, and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus." Let's pray. Father God, we come to you once again with a humble heart, with a thankful heart, with a loving heart this morning, Father. We want to thank you for the word that you've placed before us this morning, Father. I pray now that you would give us the ability to cast any distractions to the side, Father, that we would be able to focus 100% on your voice. We would be able to focus this morning 100% on your word. And Father, we pray that this morning, as we're focusing on your word, that we may be changed by your word. Father, that's what we're looking for. Father, we want to get so deep into your word. Father, we want to know you so much that it changes the way that we think, that it changes the way that we live. And Father, I pray that you would have your will and your way throughout this service. Father, I pray that today might be the day of salvation. Father, I don't know the needs of individuals that are here this morning. I don't know all the hearts of the individuals that are here this morning. But Father, I pray that through your word that you would meet the needs of the people. And Father, we love you. We thank you. For it's in Jesus' name that we pray. And amen. Guys, this past week, as I was on vacation, I had an opportunity to begin reading this little book that I have in my hand. It's called The Disciplines of the Christian Life. It's written by a missionary by the name of Eric Little. I don't know if anybody has ever read this book. I would recommend it to any individual to read. Eric Little, if you've been here for any amount of time and heard me preach, you've probably heard me mention this person's name. He's an individual that I love to read after. He's sort of a hero of my life. He was an Olympic gold medalist in 1924. He refused to run on Sundays. They actually made a movie after him called Chariots of Fire. Immediately after the Olympics, where he won the gold medal, and by the way, set a record for the 400 meters, he also won bronze, I think, in the 200 meters. He immediately left and went to China as a missionary. This was right before World War II. He found himself in a prison camp right before the end of the war. And he was doing many great things in that prison camp, where he actually died of a brain tumor about 2 months before the end of World War II. Eric Little is his name. with a statement that really stood out to me that I read in this book, and it said this. It said, as a Christian, Eric Little's desire was to know God more deeply, and as a missionary, to make him known more fully. As soon as I read that sentence, I had to stop, because it immediately stood out to me. The first thing I thought was, is that my desire? Is my desire to know God more deeply and to make him known more fully? And then secondly, I began to think, is that the desire of Bloomingdale Salem Baptist Church? And then the third thing that came to my mind, which was completely obvious, is that this should be the desire of every single Christian, of every servant of Jesus Christ. Their desire ought to be to know God more deeply and to make him known more fully. And guys, I believe that this is one of the major differences between the mature Christian and the immature Christian. I believe that at the root of this statement, we can find the source of many problems within the American church. And guys, I'm convinced that there is a large group of people that are content living their Christian lives or living their lives without knowing Jesus Christ. Now listen, this may surprise you, but I'm not talking about reprobates. I'm not talking about the vilest of sinners. I'm not even talking about the lost this morning. I'm referring to the children of God. I'm talking about out-of-court Christians. Now, those of you that have been coming on Wednesday nights, we've been going through the study on the tabernacle. You know that the tabernacle is divided into three sections, right? It has the outer court. It has the holy place and the holy of holies. I'm talking about Christians that are content living their lives in the outer court. They have no desire to get into the holy of holies, where God resides, and get one-on-one with God and devote their lives to actually knowing him. I'm talking about people that can say this. I want you to look at verse 8, that I may win Christ. These people may have that desire to win Jesus Christ. Look at verse number 9. They may have the desire to be found in him. But the statement that the Apostle Paul makes there in verse 10, where he says that I may know him, that is not their deepest desires. How many Christians do you know that are content to live their lives only knowing the historic life of Jesus Christ? They've read the Gospels. They know all of the miracles that Jesus has performed. They know his life from his birth at Bethlehem all the way to his death at Mount Calvary, through the resurrection and through the ascension. They know those things. They know the historic life of Jesus Christ, but they don't know Jesus in a way that changes their life completely. How many Christians you know that know the doctrine of Jesus Christ, but they don't know him? How many Christians do you know that understand that Jesus Christ was the ultimate sacrifice for sins? They know that. They understand that he gave his life for them, but it has not affected the way that they live out their Christian life. Folks, listen to me. When you understand that Jesus Christ loved you so much that he died for you, that he gave himself for you, that ought to affect the way you live out your Christian life. You should have a desire to know him. Amen. How many times, I know you guys have seen this, how many times have you seen a little story where somebody saved the life of another individual, whether they donated an organ, or maybe they saved them out of a fire? But when that person was rehabilitated, whenever they were able, the first thing they wanted to do whenever they got out of the hospital is they wanted to go meet the person that saved their life. They wanted to go embrace that individual. They wanted to go to that individual and give them a hug and give them a kiss. And that because they saved their life, they wanted to get to know that person. Has anybody ever heard of a story like that? You see it all of the time. Folks, I love Mount Calvary. I love the cross, but I love Jesus Christ even more. His suffering, his death, all of these things should be held close in the heart of a Christian, but they are second. The first place in our heart ought to be set aside for Jesus Christ himself. But I am convinced that there is a great amount of believers that are content that they do not strive to actually know Jesus Christ. It shouldn't be enough to hear him. It should be enough just to read of him. It's not enough. It wasn't enough for the Apostle Paul. And guys, it ought not be enough for us. We ought to have a desire to know him.
Amen.
To get to know him on a personal level. I want you to look here at his words in Philippians chapter 3, starting in verse 7. Listen to Paul. He says, "But what things were gained to me, those I counted lost for Christ. Yea, doubtless, and I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count them but dung, that I may win Christ and be found in him, not having my own righteousness which is of the law, but that which through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith," listen, "that I may know him in the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable unto his death, if by any means I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead." Paul's deepest desire was to know Jesus Christ. Now, guys, listen. Essentially, what this passage is about is what we see of the doctrine of justification. We see the doctrine of sanctification, and we see the doctrine of glorification. We can see that big time in this passage. Now, I don't have time this morning to go into all that, but what I want you to notice, what I want you to focus on, is at the beginning of verse 10, the first five words, "that I may know him." What did Paul mean whenever he wrote down those words? Now, we need to understand something. We need to understand that when Paul wrote this down, that he already knew Jesus Christ as Savior. His relationship had already been established with Jesus Christ many years earlier. He was converted on the road to Damascus. But any relationship that we have with any individual, it has to begin with an introduction, right? Every relationship begins with an introduction. Paul had already had that. I remember my relationship with Amanda. I remember when I first met her. Right? Amanda, you remember? I hope Amanda remembers. Actually, the first time I saw her was in the student center at Cabell Middle High School, but I don't think she's seen me. But I seen her, and I saw the big smile that she had on her face, and it stood out to me immediately. I mean, it was like love at first sight. And you guys may think that that's extremely cheesy, but that's just the way that it was. But the first time I met her, the first introduction was actually in the gym at Cabell Middle High School. You see, we were high school sweethearts. She was a freshman, and I was a junior. Let's see, is that right? Okay, she was a freshman, and I was a junior, so we were actually in school together for only 2 years, but I still consider us to be high school sweethearts. Do you remember the first time that you were introduced to Jesus Christ? Do you remember that introduction? You see, my introduction to Jesus may be different than your introduction to Jesus, but folks, we all had that introduction at the moment of salvation, when you first met Jesus Christ. If you're here today and you're a born-again believer, if you know Jesus, you've had that introduction with him. Paul knew Jesus Christ at this point as his Savior, but that was not enough for the Apostle Paul. He wanted to know him more. He wanted to know him deeply. He wanted to know him on an intimate, personal level. He wanted Jesus to be the Lord of his life. He wanted a relationship with Jesus Christ that was so real that it changed who he was, it changed how he acted, it changed how he lived, it changed how he thought. He wanted to be completely engulfed or entangled with Jesus Christ, where every thought, where every single action that took place in his life somehow involved Jesus Christ. He wanted to know him personally. He wanted to know the person of Jesus Christ on that intimate level. And guys, we need to understand that Jesus is not some image. He's not some myth. Jesus Christ is a person. He's fully God, and he is fully man, and we ought to have a desire to get to know him on that level. Now listen, there's many different ways that you can get to know an individual, right? You can have basic knowledge of a person. For example, somebody could walk up to me and say, "Do you know who Billy Graham is?" My answer would be yes. I've read about Billy Graham. I know that Billy Graham is from North Carolina. I know that he was an evangelist. I know that he was influential to several different presidents. I know that he preached revivals. He preached crusades. He had five children who I believe are all involved in the ministry now. He has several grandchildren, one of whom I had the opportunity to meet and hear preach the Word of God. His name is Will Graham. But I don't know Billy Graham. I have basic knowledge of Billy Graham. Amen? We can have an acquaintance. There's some people that you can meet one or two different times, and you may say that you know that individual, but you've only met them one or two times in your life. So you really don't know them. They're actually acquaintances. There's people that you can be around for years and never really know that individual because you're only around them in a certain environment. Think about your coworkers. You know your coworker pretty well. You think that you do, but you're only around that individual in the workplace. You're only around them in that environment. They may be completely different outside of that environment. So you really don't know that individual all that well. But there are people that are in our lives that we do know very well. We can get to know somebody extremely deep. You can be intertwined with an individual. You can be entangled with an individual. Think about your marriage. Think about your husband. Think about your wife. Think about that relationship that you have. Some people say that whenever you're married for a certain amount of time, they end up being like your spouse. Have you guys ever heard that? Have you guys ever heard that after you're married for a certain amount of time, they end up looking like your spouse? Have you guys ever heard that? I just want to pause for a moment. I'm just kind of looking around. Just looking around a little bit. Look at this right here. They're entangled with one another. You guys see that? It's beautiful. It's a beautiful thing. Rick and Ralph, they're married. They're entangled with one another. They have a relationship with one another. They know each other extremely well. You see, Paul wanted to know Jesus Christ so much that he became like him. Look at verse 10. That I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable unto his death. He wanted to know Christ so well that he became like Jesus Christ. That ought to be the goal of every single Christian. That ought to be our goal. Amen. Listen to the Apostle John. And this is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom thou hast sent. That they may know him. You see, that's what Paul said. That I may know him. Now he said this, that I may know him in the power of his resurrection. I'm not going to go deep into these things. I just want to touch on them this morning. You see, Paul discovered the power of his resurrection when the Lord met him on the road to Damascus. You see, it actually knocked him to the ground and it had blinded him. When a person passes from spiritual death unto spiritual life, the power of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, folks, is on full display. You know why? Because salvation does not come through human persuasion. It's the same power that raised Jesus Christ from the dead, is the same power that calls you out of your spiritual deadness and calls you unto life. We can't do that. It's the power of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. I want you to listen to Paul in Ephesians chapter 2. He says this, God, but God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us. He hath quickened us together with Christ. By grace are you saved. You see, it's nothing that we do to ourselves. It has nothing to do with what you've done. It has nothing to do with the preacher or the pastor. It has everything to do with God who gives the increase. Now, don't get me wrong. He wants to use you. He wants to use every single one of you in that process. And he will if you'll just get out of the way. If you'll just get the flesh out of the way and allow him to use you, he will use you in a mighty way. But it's the same resurrection power that's also required to sustain a believer. The power of the resurrection and the power of the Holy Spirit gives the believer power and victory over top of sin. Amen? I need that. Praise God. Anybody else need that? I'm feeling like I'm all alone here. I want to read you a passage out of Romans chapter 6. It says this. It says, let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body, that you should obey it in the lust thereof. Neither yield ye your members as instruments of righteousness unto sin, but yield yourselves unto God as those that are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness unto God. Listen to this, for sin shall not have dominion over you, for you're not under the law, but under grace. Without the resurrection power of Jesus Christ, none of this is possible. None of it. The Bible says without the resurrection power of Jesus Christ, that our faith is futile and that we are still in our sins, and our preaching is in vain. We've got to have the resurrection power of Jesus Christ. And Paul said that I may know him and the power of his resurrection. Then he goes on to say this. He goes on and he says, the fellowship of his sufferings. Now guys, this can go two different ways. This can be A, Christ's fellowship with Paul and Paul's suffering. Now, that may have been what Paul was thinking. He may have been thinking that he wanted Christ's fellowship in the midst of his own suffering. Now, we know that Paul suffered. There's no doubt. The Bible tells us that 5 times he was beaten with 40 stripes, save one. 3 times he was beaten with rods. 1 time he was stoned. He was shipwrecked. He was imprisoned. He sat in dirty, damp, wet, empty, black prison cells by himself, and I can guarantee you when he was in the midst of that, he was wanting the fellowship of Jesus Christ. I will never forget this. Man, do you remember this when we went up to Cincinnati Children's Hospital with Caden? Caden had he still has what's called an hemangioma. If you look real close, you'll see it right here on his eye. You probably noticed it before. When he was a baby, Pete and Susan may remember this. When he was a baby, that thing was enormous. It was big. It was probably, I don't know, 10 or 20 times the size that it is right now. And they were concerned that it was actually going to grow over onto his eye. So we had to take him to Cincinnati Children's Hospital for some treatments. And when we went up there that first time, they had to hook him up on a lot of different things. And he was hooked up for about 3 days, which was kind of scary. If he was just an infant, it just breaks your heart. See him laying there with all that stuff hooked up. But Mandy, do you remember the peace and the comfort that Christ's fellowship had given us during that time? You know, guys, I wasn't even worried about it. God's honesty. I can feel the prayers of our brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ. I can feel the fellowship of Jesus Christ. We weren't worried one bit. We were actually amazed. You know what? Man, we feel a great peace about this. Can you recall that in our lives? I'll never, ever forget about that. Christ's fellowship in the midst of our suffering. But it can go another way. It can also be Paul's fellowship with Christ and Christ's suffering. And that's actually the way that I lean. I think that's what he's talking about here. I want you to notice. He says fellowship of his, of Jesus' sufferings. Whenever we suffer, folks, in the name of Jesus Christ, then we get to share, we get the privilege to share in his sufferings. The early church, they counted it a great privilege to share in the sufferings of Jesus Christ. Paul said in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, for as the sufferings of Christ abound in us, so our consolation also abounded by Christ. Paul wanted to suffer for Jesus Christ. He wanted to know him so much, he wanted to be like him so much, that he was willing to suffer for him, even to the point where he says being made conformable unto his death. That word conformable means to be like an individual. Now there's all kinds of people that think that Paul's not referring to actual death here. I don't agree with that at all. I think Paul had a desire, just like 11 of the 12 disciples that died a martyr's death for Jesus Christ and counted it a privilege. I think Paul had a desire, said, you know what? I want to be made just like Jesus Christ, even unto death. He said, hey, I'm torn between this life and the next. Of course Paul thought that. Of course he thought that. Now folks, listen up. If we want to be like him, if we want to know Jesus Christ, we've got to reject the things that keep us from Jesus Christ. Look, starting there in, verse 4. Look there starting in verse 4. He says this, though I might also have confidence in the flesh, if any other man thinketh that he hath whereof he might trust in the flesh, I more. Circumcised the 8th day. Of the stock of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, is touching the law, a Pharisee, concerning zeal, persecuting the church, touching the righteousness which is in the law, blameless. But what things were gained to me, those I counted loss for Christ. Yea, doubtless, and I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge. You see that? The knowledge of knowing Jesus Christ my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count them but dung, that I may win Christ. Guys, do you realize what this is? You see, this is a list of things that
Paul thought at one point in his life would get him into heaven. You see, this was his credentials. This was his pedigree. But guys, listen, as long as we are on the throne, then Jesus Christ will never be on the throne. Paul said, all of these credentials, all of the stuff that I've done, I now count these things as a loss for the excellency of knowing Jesus Christ, my Lord. Relying upon externals will never get it. We've got to throw that stuff to the side. Do you realize that Paul had a great family? He had a great family life. He had a great education. He had all these things. But there was a change that took place in his life. There was a change of the way he saw things, the way he thought about things, the way he calculated things. He thought he was doing really well. But then all of a sudden, he realized that none of those things mattered. Do you see how radical this is? That education that he had? Folks, I'm not saying that these things don't matter in the society that we live in while we're in the here and while we're now. But folks, as far as eternity is concerned, these things don't mean so much. They mean nothing. The only thing that matters is that you know him, that I may know him with the power of his resurrection, fellowship with his sufferings, being made formal unto his death. That's the only thing that matters. Paul said all of those things. All those things that I had, all those things that I gained, I now count for a loss. He said, I've lost all things. Look what he says there. I've lost all things. And do count them, but dung. Pretty radical, right? Let me ask you a question. If you died today, what would be your list? What would be the list that you present to God? Here's what I've done with it. Here it all is. Or, when you stand before God, you have the ability to say, not me, but Jesus. Yeah. You see, that's where the rubber meets the road. There's two banners in this world. That's it. There's two groups of people. Those that have Christ and those that do not have Christ. That is it. That's the only two banners that even exist. Amen? None of these things mean anything without a relationship with Christ. And folks, just to know him as Savior is not enough for the Christian. We want to get to know him deeply, more intimately. We want to continue to grow and to get to know him. That's the Christian life. Do you know what it takes to get to know an individual? I mean, whenever I met a man, you know what I had to do? I had to spend time with her. And back then, we had phones that had the little cords on them that were spiral. You kids ever seen one of them? Matter of fact, the phone that we had the little thing that you would, like, turn, and you let go, and it spin back. You guys remember those? We didn't have cell phones. I think pagers were getting ready to get kind of popular. Remember that place where people wear them on the outside of their pocket? They had different colors, and see-through ones, and all that stuff. But we had to talk on telephone. Here's my point. I had to spend time with her. You want to get to know Jesus Christ? You have got to spend time with him. Think about the relationship that you have with your spouse. Think about the relationship that you have with your husband or the relationship that you have with your wife. All of the time, all of the effort that's been put into that relationship, all the communication that's required in that marriage. To know Jesus Christ in a deep, personal way, you've got to spend time in his word. The Bible says to desire the sincere milk of the Word of God, that you may grow thereby, that you may get closer to him, that you may grow. Secondly, you've got to be able to hear and listen to his Spirit that lives within you. You've got to open up your ears. You've got to have a healthy, open, honest prayer life. And by the way, guys, the reading of the Word of God and the prayer life thing, they like Kool-Aid and sugar, peanut butter and jelly. I mean, they go together. You've got to set aside a time in your life, the mornings, whatever, to get in the Word of God and pray. Folks, there's not a better way to start off the day than by doing that. It's a spiritual discipline. That book I told you about, the disciplines of the Christian life. It takes discipline. But folks, if you want to get to know Jesus Christ, these are the things that you have to do. And listen, most importantly, fourth on that list, is you have to be willing to be changed might be the hardest one on the list. Although, I would be willing, I don't want to use that word. Yeah, I don't know that, but I would be willing to bet. I'm not a gambling man. That 90% of Christians don't set time aside to get into the Word of God when you do not have a healthy prayer. 90%. But I still think the bottom line is the hardest for most people. Because there can be people inside of the church that say, you know what? I set aside time every day and I get into the Word of God. There's probably people in the church that say, you know what? I'm setting aside a time to have a healthy prayer life. But there's people, those same people that do that may not be willing to be changed because they think they've already arrived. They think that they're exactly where they need to be. Guys, we're never where we need to be, ever. That's the Christian life. We're constantly growing. If you think that you are exactly where you need to be in your Christian life, guys, you're dead wrong. I feel sorry for you. You've got to be willing to be changed. Listen to 2 Corinthians 3:18. But we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even by the Spirit of the Lord. That word that Paul uses there, change, that's the Greek word metamorpho. That's where we get the English word metamorphosis. You guys ever heard that? I have a hard time actually saying it. I had to say it like over and over again this past week because I was afraid I was going to say it wrong. I kept wanting to say metamorphosis. You guys know what that is, right? That's when God, that's what happens when God changes a worm into a butterfly. That starts out as a caterpillar. Thank you, Felicia. I always look at Felicia when it comes to that. It's a beautiful thing, isn't it? When God takes an ugly looking worm, it changes it, transforms it into a beautiful butterfly. You see, that's what he does with us. He will take the vilest, nastiest sinner, the most selfish individual, and he will transform that person into somebody that's in the very image of his son Jesus Christ. That's what he'll do. It's a change of appearance. It's a change of character. It's a change of condition. It's a change of function. But he will change you. But you have to allow him to do that. See, that's what the Word of God will do to us. Come on, Pastor. The Word of God will change us. It will show us our need in our life. It's just like a mirror. Did anybody look in a mirror this morning? No one here looked in a mirror. Now, bull. You guys looked in a mirror this morning. I know a bunch of y'all spent all kinds of time in front of the mirror. I looked in the mirror this morning. I never like what I see in the mirror. Especially when I'm up close and the lighting's really good. I'm like, excuse me, this is bad. Losing all my hair. Starting to grow it. In my ears, just move from here on to here. But you see, the Word of God will show you yourself. Amen. When you get into that Word, it'll begin to show you yourself and where you need to change. It'll begin to show you things that you never thought that it would show you before. It'll begin to show you, like in my instance, you know what? Chris, you need to be a better father. You need to be the best Christian in the world that those kids have ever seen in their entire life. You need to be an example for them. You see, when I get into the Word of God, I see things like that. It hurts me. It cuts me down. That's why many people don't like to get into the Word of God. But it's going to show you where you need to get better. Amen? It's going to help you to grow. And guys, I'm not inviting you here this morning to come and just have some mere knowledge of Jesus Christ. I'm inviting you this morning to come up to this altar to have a personal relationship with Him and to know Him. That's exactly what Paul said, that I may know Him. Do you want to know Him? Keith, it'll change your life. It'll flip it upside down. It'll change your life forever. You see, Paul thought he was somebody, Keith. He thought he was somebody special. He had all the pedigree. He had all the credentials. He had done all kinds of things. He thought he was special. Does anybody here this morning think that you're special? See, Jesus will take that right away. He'll take it right from you. And what he'll do is he'll make you realize that if you're a sinner. And in the sight of God, even at our best,
not on the basis of anything that you've done, but on the basis of what he's done and on the basis of your great need for him. Christian, believer, follower, you have a great need to grow in him. Do you have a desire to know him more? This has been on my mind for the heart this entire week. Remember the first thing I said whenever I read that statement? To know him more deeply and to make him known more fully. The first thing I asked myself is that my desire. You see, I had to examine myself. Amen. Father God, we come to you once again. We're so thankful for this time that you've given us here this morning. Father, we're so thankful for your word and how it's a mirror, how we can look into the word, Father, and we can see our need for you. We can see our need to know you more. Father, how we can see ourselves and where we need to change. And Father, we pray, dear Lord, that if there's an area inside of our life this morning that we need to cut loose, if there's an area inside of our life this morning that we need to change, Father, we pray that you would show us that through the power of your Holy Spirit and through the Word of God. Now, Father, I pray if there's an individual here today that's lost, if there's someone here that's never known your Son, never had that initial introduction at the moment of salvation, Father, we pray that today would be the day of salvation. That right now would be the accepted time. That we wouldn't wait till tomorrow. That we would do it today. Father, I pray if there's an individual here today that's already saved, that's out of fellowship with you, that needs to get closer to you, that needs to know you more, Father, I pray that you would place that upon their heart. I pray that your voice, that your word would place that upon their heart. Father, I pray as a church, move forward, Father, I pray that we would always have a desire to know you. Father, we would always fix our eyes on your Son, Jesus Christ, that we wouldn't look away, that we would look to the prize of the high calling of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Father, we want to thank you once again for who you are and what you've done. Most of all, Father, today we want to thank you
for the love that you've shown us through your Son, Jesus Christ. What he did at Calvary. How he died for each and every single one of us that is here this morning. He died for us. Father, because of that, I pray that you would give us a desire to run to you, to meet you, to know you. We love you, we thank you.